Okay. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. شباب جدة معنا ولا؟ Okay. Today theme will be about the meningioma. So I'll be the first presenter and I'll be talking about the surgical treatment and meningioma recurrence. And my colleagues will continue talking about the other types of meningioma. The contents of my presentation, we'll talk first about the definition of meningioma. And after that, we'll talk about the cell of origin of meningioma and what is the blood supply of the meninges. And then we'll talk about the pathological classification according to the WHO. And then the anatomical classification and the, what are the radiological findings in meningioma. And then we'll talk about what is the principle of meningioma resection, including Simpson grading system or classification. And at the end, we'll talk about the meningioma recurrence. So the definition of meningioma is, it is the most common primary brain tumor. And it is mostly benign tumor, but it can come present as a malignant type. We'll come to the classification. And mostly it's a slow growing tumor and it arises from the meningothelial cells of the arachnoid layer. We'll come to the specific site of the origin. The presentation of meningioma depends on the site of the meningioma. Some of the epidemiology about it, it is the lifetime risk of developing meningioma approximately reaching 1%. And the median age of developing the tumor is 65. But as you can see here, most of the tumor, they have peaks. So the tumor will have an age group when the tumor become very prevalent and with high incidence, then it will go down. But this is not the case in meningioma. In meningioma, as the patient or the population get older, the risk of getting meningioma will become higher. And the ratio between male and female is high. The female, they have a higher incidence of meningioma, 3.1 to 1 in males. But after menopause, this is pre-menopause. But after the menopause, as you can see here, the ratio differences between the both genders will go down. But the incidence of the tumor will become higher. The cell of origin of the meningioma is from the arachnoid capsules. As you can see here, this is the brain and this is the subarachnoid space. This is the arachnoid matter, the cell of the arachnoid meningothelial cells. And as you can see here, the arachnoid will protrude inside the sinus. This is what they call it, arachnoid granulation. And the area that is in contact with the endothelium of the sinuses called the arachnoid capsules. And this is the origin of the meningioma. The most common site of these arachnoid villi is in the superior sagittal sinus, followed by the cavernous sinus, tuberculum cellae, and the lamina cribrosa, and the foramen magnum and trochlear herophily. The blood supply of the meninges can be classified, mostly it's from the external carotid, but it can come from the internal carotid, and they classify it according to the fossas of the brain. So anterior fossa, middle fossa, and posterior fossa. In the anterior fossa, mainly the meningeal arteries, they come from the through the anterior and the posterior ethmoidal foramen, and from the anterior and posterior ethmoidal artery, which comes from the ophthalmic artery, and the also the middle meningeal artery, from which foramen they come, or they enter the intracranial area, space. Spinosum, foramen spinosum. Okay, and here you can see the other meningeal arteries that come from the ascending pharyngeal artery, and here the two branches, one from the vertebral artery and the other one from the occipital artery. And this is a table that can summarize what we have said. You can read it literally. So what is the radiological findings of meningioma? In a plain X-ray, you can see hyperostosis of the bone, thickening of the bone that is adjacent to the tumor. And you can see increased vascular marking, especially the middle meningeal artery. And if the tumor is calcified, you can see it through the, in the plain X-ray. So in the plain CT scan of the head, usually this tumor will be isodense to slightly hyperdense in comparison to the brain parenchyma. And mostly they will, and as you can see here, there is hyperostosis of the bone. And most of them, they have a homogeneous enhancement. But in the MRI, in the T1 weighted images, most of them, in almost 60% of the tumor will be isodense. And in almost 30%, they will be hypodense to the brain parenchyma. And in the T2 imaging, 50% isodense and the rest is hyperdense, slightly hyperdense. And hyperdensity can give you a hint about the type of the meningioma. Because hyperintensity in T2 means that it has a high water content. So this is could be a meningoethelial because it secretes a high amount of fluid, or a high grade tumor. And also it can give you a hint during surgical resection. Because high water content means easily suckable tumor. And as you can see here, the cuff of CSF around the tumor, this is indicates an extra-axial lesion. And in the contrasted image, you can see the dural enhancement or the dural tail. Sometimes you will do for those patients, especially in the skull-based meningiomas, you will do the cerebral angiogram to assess the feeding arteries of those pain, whether it's coming from external carotid, internal carotid, and if there is any possibility to embolize the tumor. The main characteristics or the mother-in-law sign or phenomenon. The tumor will fill, will have a high blood supply to it in the early arterial phase, and it will stay, the blush will stay there even till the end of the venous phase. So what is the WHO classification? It's classified as grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3. In grade 1, there is multiple types according to the histopathological finding, including meningioethelial, fibroblastic, transitional, which is the one in between, somometas, angiomatous, microcystic, secretory, and lymphocyte-rich rich, meningioma, and metaplastic. In the grade 2, there is three types: atypical meningioma, clear cell meningioma, and the chordoid. And in the grade 3, there is rhabdoid, papillary, and anaplastic. As you can see here, this is a grade 1. And in this picture, here, as you can see, there is a high number of the epithelial cells, well-differentiated epithelial cells, and that arranged in bundles. And these bundles are separated by a thin layer of the collagen. This is a meningoethelial meningioma. In this picture, as you can see, there is a spindle shaped of cells that arranged in a parallel pattern, and it's intersected with area of collagen matrix. You can see it here. This is fibroblastic, high fibrous content. And the somometus, which is the horal, and which is contains round areas that contain calcium content. Transitional is something in between. When you have an areas of meningoethelial with, the same time you have a large area of fibroblastic areas, so we call it as transitional, in between the two types. Grade two, it's the, one of the examples is atypical meningioma. And the definition of it, when you have a mitotic activity, the definition of it, mitotic activity four or more per term high power field with three or more of the following: increased cellularity, small cell with high nucleus to cytoplasmic ratio, prominent nucleoli, and uninterrupted patternless or sheet-like growth, or foci or a foci of spontaneous or geographic necrosis. And grade 3, which is the malignant type, usually in those patients, they the mitotic activity will be much higher. And the WHO, they said it's 20 or more of mitosis in high-power field, or if you see an invasion of the normal parenchyma around the tumor. So regarding the surgical treatment, meningioma is a surgical tumor. It's resected surgically, and you can reach a total cure with the complete surgical resection. But there are some obstacles depending on the site of the lesion and the grade of the lesion. And the grading system that is used to classify meningiomas after resection is the Simpson grading system. So if you have a complete macroscopic gross total resection of the tumor and you resected the involved dura and the involved bone, this is grade 1. Grade 2, when you gross total resection of the tumor and coagulation of the involved dura, this is grade 2. 3, when you only resect the tumor macroscopically, complete resection, but you didn't resect or coagulate the dura or the involved bone. This is grade 3. And grade 4, when you only do subtotal removal of the tumor. This is especially sometimes in parasagittal meningioma when it is invading the sinuses, dural sinuses. So you leave some part on the wall of the sinus. And grade 5 is only simple decompression or debulking of the tumor. Grade 0, when you remove a margin of the dura around 2 centimeters from the tumor. So what is the recurrence of the meningioma? The recurrence of meningioma depends on multiple factors, including the extent of the resection. So in grade 1, the risk of recurrence is 9%, and it keeps increasing as you reach the grade 5. Okay, grade 5, simply you didn't remove the tumor, you just decompress it. So the recurrence is very high. It's a tumor cell and it will grow regardless. And also it can be classified, the recurrence can be, you can get hint about the recurrence from the classification. The higher grade of the meningioma, the higher risk of recurrence, reaching almost 50 to 70% in anaplastic meningioma of grade 3. And in grade 1, 9%. Grade 2 is 29%. What are the other factors that help you in predict the future recurrence? The location of the tumor. So skull-based located tumor involving the an important structures like nerves or an important artery, or if it is invading the sinuses, in those cases the risk of recurrence is higher. And you mentioned about the histopathological type. Now we'll talk about each type of the meningioma. The anatomical classification, they classify it according to the site. So we have convexity meningioma, parasagittal meningioma, sphenoid wing meningioma, tuberculum cell meningioma, palinum sphenoidal meningioma, supracellular type meningioma, and or vitroclival or foramen magnum. So simply any area or spinal meningioma. So any part of the brain that has meninges, the patient can develop meningioma at that site. Also, rarely, meningioma can occur at the intraventricular space. So the most common type is the convexity meningioma, comprising around 35%, followed by the parasagittal meningioma in 20%, then the sphenoid wing meningioma, then the rest. So the convexity meningioma, according to Cushing classification, he classified it according to the site as a pre-coronal, anterior to the coronal sutures, coronal at the site of the coronal suture, post-coronal, paracentral, parietal, occipital, and temporal. And the presentation depends on the site of the tumor and the... So this is surgical technique of removing those tumor. Usually after you plan the site, the incision site, according to either the neuronavigation or your anatomical landmark, the craniotomy, the edges of the craniotomy has to be far from the edges of the tumor So you can play, see the plane that is between the tumor and between the normal parenchyma of the cortex. And after that, after doing the craniotomy, the dura has to be opened in circumferential pattern. And depending on the site of the tumor, either you removed it as a whole, or you dissect it from, or debulk it from within the tumor, and then you devascularize it from the outer capsule of the tumor. But you have to preserve the cortex and the cortical vein that is just underneath the tumor. The second type is the parasagittal meningioma. How can you differentiate between parasagittal and convexity meningioma? Like if you have the tumor in this area, same as the site of the size of this tumor, but it is located here. What you will say, this is a convexity meningioma or parasagittal? Yeah, by definition, parasagittal meningioma, it is filling the sagittal plane or sagittal angle, and there is no brain tissues between the tumor and the sinus. As you can see here, there is no brain tissues in between. So this is a parasagittal meningioma, and they classify it according to the anterior one third, middle third, and posterior third. And because most of those tumors, they are in contact with the sinuses, so there is a classification regarding the degree of involvement. So if it is involving only the attaching the lateral wall, this is type 1. If it is invading the rhesus, this is type 2. Type 3, when it is invading the lateral wall. Type 4, when the lateral wall and the lateral rhesus is involved or invaded. Type 5, when it is total occlusion of the sinus. And type 6, when it is passing the sinus to the other side. Regarding the surgical technique, it's almost the same, but here you have the sinus which is involved. So if the sinus is partially occluded, or it's the tumor is invading the lateral wall with no occlusion of the sinus, you have three options. Either you leave portion of the tumor that is attached to the sinus, but you have to keep in mind that this tumor will grow in the future gradually, and it will obstruct the sinus. But at that time, this resection will be simple because those patients, they will develop the collaterals. So you can resect it completely. The second option, when you can resect part of the sinus and reconstruct it or putting a patch around it, but the patency of the sinus afterward will be around 50% in human, and there is a risk of sinus thrombosis. The third option, usually you do it in the anterior one third when you remove the ligate the sinus, but there is a risk also of venous sinus thrombosis. This is all. My colleague now will talk about specific types of meningiomas. If you have any question, you can ask. Dr. Walid. Type 2 meningioma. Type 2 is not invading. Type 3. Type 3 is invading. Invasion of the normal tissues, this is a characteristic of malignant tumors. Yeah, we mentioned what is the definition of grade 2. We said it's meningioma with 4 or more mitotic activity in 10 high power field with 3 of the following. We mentioned interrupted growth pattern, and there is 5 of them or 6 of them. You can review it later on.
Some pathologies,
they consider it slow KI-67. They would consider the tumor grade 2 invading the brain with low metabolic. I'm not sure. Grade 3. Are there any other questions? Yes, sir.